Good morning, class of 2015. Okay. Thank you for the enthusiasm. I appreciate it. So, each year, the 10th grade students meet to discuss their future options. Each of you met with me in December to discuss your IB course options for your junior and senior year. If you remember, I mentioned this event as a reason for why we were meeting in December. This event, the IB Forum, is an important George Mason High School tradition that provides advice to you from the most important stakeholders in our community, our students. You have the distinct opportunity, this is something that does not occur in most high schools. So I would emphasize that you guys have the distinct opportunity to ask graduates questions as you prepare to make important decisions about your future as juniors and seniors in high school. You may remember in our meetings in December in the TLC, I shared important reasons for you to consider challenging yourselves academically where appropriate. I shared information about what research says about the relationship between challenging yourself in high school and success in college, if that's the path you choose next. Specifically, I shared information about research about the relationship between IB courses and success in college. Research, however, lacks the type of personal meaning and significance that our panelists may provide you today. I want to remind you of something before we start that I said at our meeting. I emphasized to you guys that the IB diploma and IB courses are one path to success at George Mason High School. A majority of you will choose that path, but it is one path. You're very blessed to be at a school that offers you many options. So we're here today to give you a further orientation on one of those options as you enter junior and senior year. Please join me in welcoming 10 students, all very different types of learners, 11 students, excuse me, that are here to talk to you about their IB experiences at George Mason High School. We'll give them a round of applause after I'm done introducing them. As I say your names, please stand up and wave to your buddies. Please welcome Eric Carlson. He's a class of 2011 graduate. He's an IB diploma recipient. He's at the University of South Carolina. He's a sophomore majoring in sports and entertainment management. Claire Constance is a class of 2012 IB diploma recipient. She's a UVA freshman and Eccles scholar, majoring in cognitive science with a focus on public health and possibly minoring in Spanish. Michelle DeMars is a class of 2012 IB diploma recipient, Tufts University freshman and NCAA athlete in cross country and track. She's majoring in psychology and child development. Merrick Waltala is a class of 2012 IB AP courses student who's at Guilford College. He's a freshman majoring in psychology and environmental studies. Aaliyah Ensign is a class of 2011 IB diploma recipient studying at the College of William and Mary. She's a sophomore there majoring in psychology and Chinese language and culture. Leah Roth is a class of 2012 IB courses student. She's at University of Mary Washington. She's a freshman majoring in biology, and she is also an NCAA athlete playing soccer. Christian Lopez Flores is a class of 2009 IB diploma recipient. He's a senior at Virginia Tech, and he's majoring in engineering. Ben Mothershead is a class of 2012 IB diploma recipient. He's a freshman at Grinnell College. He's currently undecided in his major. I want you guys to know that's an option too. Surya Namanduri is a graduate of Virginia Commonwealth University. She is a George Mason High School class of 2008 IB diploma recipient. So she's graduated from high school here, college successfully. She's been accepted to medical school at the Western University of Health Sciences in California, where she hopes to prepare to become an OBGYN. I feel like I had more to say, but I will remember when I get to it. Allison Cunningham is a class of 2013 IB diploma candidate. So she's a senior here at the school. In case you have questions that only current students can answer, she's also on the IB Student Advisory Board, which represents all IB students, courses, and certificate students to advocate on your behalf. Christina Holman is a class of 2013 IB diploma candidate, current senior. She's the chairperson of the IB Student Advisory Board, again, that represents the interests of the students to the school. Please join me in welcoming this panel. This is the first year ever we have students who graduated Mason last year and students who graduated Mason 5 years ago and who've already graduated college. So it's a very diverse group of students who I hope you'll take advantage of asking questions today, and we'll get to that in a little bit. So in today's conversation, I will begin by asking a set of predetermined questions. However, if you guys remember, we talked about being intellectual risk takers in the TLC, right? Yes, thank you for the confirmation. I appreciate it. Oh, there's my buddy. All right. So when you have a question, and I know you do because you guys asked the best questions. Sorry, guys. In my 5 years here, you asked the best questions of any class so far in that session we had in the TLC. So when you have a question, line up in that aisle there. You see there's a microphone in the aisle. So just stand up in front of the microphone. I'll know you have a question if you're standing there, and I'll call on you at that time, okay? So let's begin. My first question for these students are, as you'll discover in the future, they're in college, so they have like a 4-week vacation right now. They're all on vacation right now. Most of them haven't gotten up this early yet, the entire vacation. So they're taking time away from their holiday to give back to the school community. So my first question is, what inspired you to come today? Why did you want to talk to the class of 2015? And I believe Surya is going to start us off with her answer to that question.
So I'm actually not on holiday. But
that's correct. I forgot. She's taking time away from her work.
Yes. I wanted to come back and talk to you all because I think it's important not just to be prepared for college, but also for life. And I think I have a little bit of perspective on, I mean, obviously not a lot, I'm still only 22, but I have some perspective on what happens after college and how the IB has helped me, you know, 5 years down the road.
Eric?
Okay, am I close enough to Mike? Let's figure this out. I guess I wanted to come back because when I was a sophomore, this whole process really changed my view on not only school, but how I like live life and like time management and the whole thing like that. It really, I don't know, it better prepared me for where I am today. So I think that this is an incredibly important thing. I just wanted to be here to give my opinions.
Claire.
I am here for a variety of reasons, but one of the most important to me right now being that IB helped me figure out what I want to do right now in college, and it's helping me choose what classes I want to take for next semester and the semesters to come.
Merrick?
Okay, so the main reason I came back was to talk about how you can be successful even if you don't do the diploma just by taking certificate classes and AP courses, and how that still can lead to a positive experience during college.
Wonderful. Everyone else will answer different questions, but not every student's going to answer every question for the sake of time. So the first question I have, still excited for you guys to get in line. Now that you've interacted with graduates, now that you've interacted with graduates from both IB, AP, and other types of high schools who didn't have the same opportunity as you did at George Mason, what do you believe you may have gotten out of the IB program, either as a courses student or a diploma student, that you think maybe other students, your peers, may not have gotten, and how does that relate to your college experience?
I have experience with that because a lot of people in South Carolina haven't heard of the IB diploma or the IB program. And so I know a bunch of people that have done AP or just normal high school stuff, and I found that I have a lot more in-depth knowledge and I'm able to critically think a lot better, which makes the workload a little easier for me, at least, just because I don't have to like go learn everything again, and I can make inferences and I can work around things that I don't know to still get the right answer. So for me, it's just made me a little bit more prepared. It makes it a little easier for me to work.
And you're finding yourself successful in college now for the standards you set for yourself.
I just want to disagree slightly. I think sometimes, you know, if you're not practicing something every day, you're not going to remember the facts that you learned in high school, you know, 2 years, 3 years down the road in college. That's kind of a fact. But the IB is going to teach you how to learn and how to be successful in classes that you don't know the material. and you're seeing it for the first time. It's going to teach you how to read effectively. It's going to teach you how to respond effectively, because you have to do it so much in high school. And so that's going to really help you down the road, where some of your colleagues will be, you know, stressing about writing a 10-page paper, but you've done it a million times.
I want to say the goal of IB is not to make a machine of knowledge out of you. It's to make of you people who are thirsty for knowledge. If you, when you go to college, you'll realize that, yeah, you can take a class and memorize this and that and get an A on the exam. But to be honest, when you look for a job, employers want you to be curious and passionate about what you do. So you have to be careful when you take in high school and also college. But eventually, you want to be able to learn on your own.
One of the biggest things that I found that...
Yeah, can you grab... You guys can just pull the mics to yourselves. Or as close as you can. Yeah, that's good. Just leave it right there.
One of the biggest things that I found the IB diploma helped me with was just writing at a college level, because we write so much and in so many different classes. Like, I wrote, you know, 10-page papers in calc for this past semester, and that type of, you know, interdisciplinary writing, I don't think that a lot of other students who haven't done IB can do as well. And it's just because IB teaches you how to apply and like relate knowledge from lots of different areas, and I think that's really helpful in college, just because you can write and know that you can, you know, write a 10-page paper, like someone already said, and just be done with it, and it's not a big deal.
Anybody else?
The last thing that I would say is the IB diploma, it requires you to take IB courses in each of the subject areas. And for me, coming into college, I felt prepared with all my general education requirements, because no subject was like foreign or new or scary to me, because I had experience at least in one class for every subject area.
Could any of you speak on any specific class experiences you had here your junior, senior year that you, at some point in a course, really felt that it gave you a skill set that helped you to be successful in that specific class experience?
I took IB SL History here for my senior year, and we had assignments like for reading every single night, basically. And you'll realize once you get to college, you read a ton. And that's not just in a history class, it's in almost every class. So I feel like it really prepared me to read a ton in college.
Any other specific course experiences that you felt directly helped you?
Does TOK count?
It's a course.
Okay.
We're talking about the theory of knowledge class that we had discussed.
I feel like that on some level there's a lot of TOK just gets a bad rap, because it's this weird class that nobody really knows what it is until you're sitting in there with Mr. Scharf and he's trying to explain to you the different areas of knowledge and ways of knowing. And on some level, it's that itself is a little superficial, but the way you learn to think and ask questions in that class is going to change your life. Mr. Scharf is a phenomenal teacher, if I'm allowed to give plugs for teachers,
yes,
at least.
You are.
And he does a really great job of using the curriculum to explore a whole just plethora of different ideas and subjects and current issues that are going to really help you put your current high school curriculum in a more global perspective, which is not something that my junior year in high school I thought was possible, nor did I think my classes were relevant to anything outside of George Mason. So even if you're not a diploma candidate, from what I know, you can now take TOK and get recognition for that just through IB. And I would really encourage you guys to take that more than even the IB subject classes, because those are great. And if you decide to do diploma or certificate, they're going to help you. But TOK is going to put them all at a greater frame of reference for you.
Well, hello, guys. I'm a current student, so I haven't had graduate experience. But I did want to emphasize the point that even though you take the IB diploma, this isn't something where years later all the developments flourish, as it seems that in college you do see kind of where the benefits of IB diploma, but is it a continual learning process? Even as I'm picking classes now, as you said with IB TOK, you are starting to learn within yourself. You're starting to ask questions by yourself if you go around the day, have discussions with your family or your friends. So this is continual development. You'll see the benefits of having an IB diploma program or a certificate class, whichever you choose, as you go through. So don't think that you're just taking this for years to go down the road, but you're taking it for the now and for yourself.
Hi, this is very low. I took IB higher level English, and we were talking a lot about critical thinking and writing, and I can guarantee any of you, pretty much any career you choose, you're gonna have to write, be that a proper paper or just emails to and forth with coworkers. But specifically, the English course that I took in high school, I took my BritLit course, which is a GER, this semester in college, and that ability to analyze and write quickly really helped on the midterm. I was the only student to finish the midterm, which I think also speaks to the difference between IB students and students who've taken AP classes and other tracks in high school.
One last class that I just want to quickly bring your attention to that I don't think enough people know about is IB Anthropology. If you're all at all looking for classes that are just going to inspire you to learn about new things or change the way you already do think about things, IB Anthro is going to teach you so much. And also, I think more than any of the classes that I took at Mason, even though I also really appreciated having taken HL English, it was the most like a college class in its form and structure. It was pretty much a lecture class. We watched lots of movies and read some interesting articles, but it wasn't as structured as a lot of other classes I have had. It was more a continual navigation of the different areas of knowledge within anthropology that we were studying. But it completely transformed the way that I looked at my college education. And so I would definitely encourage that.
Go ahead.
Oh, one thing I thought was really cool, or I just remember last year when I was taking HL English, I was writing a paper on The Sun Also Rises, which is a required reading for the course. And I wrote about it through an anthropological perspective that, you know, I kind of learned to write about through taking IB Anthropology. And so those kind of interdisciplinary benefits that I thought are really helpful, and you'll see that in all sorts of classes, like being able to apply calculus principles to physics, or, you know, chemistry to physics, or, you know, there's all sorts of different ways you can combine knowledge from other courses. And you're going to do a lot of that in college, and so that's one of the things that I think IB is really good at. It kind of takes a liberal arts holistic perspective on knowledge rather than segmenting it into very separate chunks and areas.
I know when we met in December, all of you, and I met in December, a lot of you had questions and very sincere concerns about workload. How many of you are concerned about homework over the next 2 years of your life? Really high, really high. Keep your hands up, please. When you asked me those questions, I said, keep your hands up. When you asked me those questions, I said, I didn't answer them. I said, you should ask the students who experienced the IB program here. So which of you with your hands up now has the courage and forethought to be a risk taker and ask our first question today? Remember my use of awkward silence in the TLC. I will continue to wield it. Go for it. Come on up. Yes. Thank you. Let's give this risk taker a loud round of applause. Mr. Bird showed us this wonderful TED Talk that proves this point that when one person has to take that plunge, and when they do that, the rest of us gain the courage to rise. So please get in line with your questions.
What is the average nightly workload for taking?
Do you mean like
IB
how
courses?
Late we stayed up, how long we were working?
In high school?
Yeah.
And if you could talk about how that correlates to college, just so they get a sense about college too.
I can speak to this one. My last 2 years in high school, I was taking nine classes, two of them were on contract, and my extracurriculars for the CAS hours. and I was going to bed by 10 every night. I think the latest I stayed up was midnight, and that was a partner on my group project hadn't sent me something. So it really is, you can manage the workload and sleep and see friends. You can have a social life. And in college, you'll find that you take less hours. The course load is done by credits, and it varies from college to college. But you might be in class for, I don't know, maybe 4 hours, 5 hours max a day, and then studying. But you have a lot of time in college, and it's really up to you to manage that time. And I think the IB Diploma program, though it's more structured because you have a lot of time in school, it does a good job of setting you up with good time management skills, because you have to be able to do that to manage the whole course load. So.
So I have to really think here, but I'm pretty sure in high school I did stay up, late meaning like 12, and that's not like every night, like it would be before a test or before something was due. I'm of the type of learner where I like to wake up early in the morning instead of stay up late, so I would do that as well. But I remember there being a stark difference between high school and college. Like, this is an extreme example, but my senior year, I had a five-day weekend every week. I didn't have class on Monday and Friday. So, you know, there is a lot of time in college, like, that more time than you need. And so, for that reason, I think it helps, because you need to know how to structure that time. You know, when you have, like, so many hours to do so few things, that means you need to spend more time on each thing. And it can be hard, because with the IB you're trying to fit everything in, but when you procrastinate, then it comes into handy.
Yeah, about procrastinating. So I just remember at the end of sophomore year, I had I didn't have that much structure. I wasn't too organized. And part of the challenge with IB was trying to fit everything in together and make it work and come into school the next day with all your assignments done. And at first I struggled with that, and I didn't get too much sleep, but then after that, it didn't even take that long. After a couple months, I was fine. And I think that's the main thing that it taught me, is just to really structure your time. And now I finish everything pretty much, so, and I get enough sleep.
So I've actually found that personally I'm not very good at structuring my time, so I like to fill my day with things that will help me to do so. So at Mason I did cross country swimming and track, and then I was on the student government and I had to do, you know, extracurriculars and things like that. So I filled up my day, and then I knew, okay, when I get home, I have to do my homework because I have this chunk of time that's being set aside for athletics and this chunk of time that's being set aside for school. And I've continued that in college, and I think it's really helpful for me, at least, because in college you do have a lot more time. You're not sitting in school, you know, just watching a movie or something. When there's a substitute, you just won't have class or something like that. But yeah, for me, it was just having things to help me structure my time. And I think that doing the IB diploma encourages you to do other activities, which, you know, are good for that purpose.
So Aaliyah started us out by saying she went to bed at 10. A doctor would tell you, you guys are supposed to get 9 hours of sleep. And that, when I told you that in the TLC, you laughed, right, if you remember. That means if you're not taking a contract class in the morning, you go to bed asleep by 10 p.m. at night. And I want to be very honest about the answer to this question, because I know not every student goes to bed at 10. And what I shared with you in the TLC was my observation, and I'm not a student, so I want you guys to speak on this matter, is I said that you guys have developed certain habits already by 10th grade, when you go to sleep, how you handle your homework, et cetera. And I'm not always sure that the diploma program is going to change those habits for the worst, in the sense that at least your sleep habits have already been developed. They might exacerbate those habits. To what degree do you agree with that, what I shared with them? And how was your experience with homework different than Aaliyah's?
I had a very similar experience as Aaliyah. I don't think there was a day that I wasn't done with homework by 9:45, 10. That's not to say I went to bed right then, but I mean, my own personal reasons, I just don't like to sleep. And then, so I mean, from that standpoint, I had a very similar experience. And on the point of how it changes your habits, the IB diploma, like, absolutely just, like, tore apart, like, every habit I had from the first 2 years of high school. Like, I was a very, like, procrastinating student, not a huge emphasis on school itself, just more of just the experience getting through it. And then I made this decision to do a diploma, and there is no, like, you can do it later, because there are these set deadlines that the entire world, like, does, and you're not going to be that one person that changes the entire world's deadline. Like, that doesn't work. So for me, it changed the way I did everything. And this term we're going to say a lot, time management, is, like, that is the biggest thing I got from the IB diploma, like, beyond any set of knowledge, just the ability to lay out my day and get everything done without ripping my hair out halfway through. So, I mean, just the way the diploma changed all of my habits is really awesome.
I don't know. For me, I think that, like, the habits that you have right now as 10th graders, I don't know if you guys love pre-IB classes.
We don't call them that, but they are pre-IB classes, yes. Yeah. All CP and honors courses in 9th and 10th grade in the 6 IB subjects lead to an IB course.
Okay. So we used to call them pre-IB classes, but in those classes, I was already doing, you know, pretty, like, intensive work. Like, I already had, like, a lot on my plate by 10th grade. And so moving from, you know, 9th and 10th grade into the upper levels of high school, I mean, you're going to do what you already do. If you want to make those sacrifices, then you will do them. But it's not going to be an overnight thing. It'll be something that happens eventually. You know, you're going to change your habits over time. It's not going to seem like something that happens overnight. You know, once other things start piling on, like college applications, that kind of thing, then you might feel a little stressed, and there's going to be times where you're going to feel more stressed than other times, which you guys already go through. I mean, before final, I'm sure right now you guys are all a little bit on edge in school because you're ready to take your finals. And so obviously right now, like, you're going to be more stressed out than, you know, September 9th, for example. So I think the things that you already do will still continue throughout your life, but little things will change. I don't think people will change overnight. So,
did you have a secondary question?
Yes.
Go for it.
Not necessarily related, but how difficult was it for you guys to fulfill your CAS hours, and, like, what did you do for them?
So I think that with the whole IB program in general, especially the diploma, what scares people is the wide variety of things that you need to do by the end of your 2 years to fulfill all the different requirements. But I think the biggest mistake that people make in that is not choosing things that make them happy. They do CAS projects just to fulfill the requirement to get the signature from tutoring hours, whatever you want. They do an extended essay topic that they actually don't like, and then they have to spend a year studying something that's not that interesting to them, and it feels like a chore. So, for instance, with my CAS project, if you will, I interned at a free clinic over the summer, and I love Spanish, and so I spent that summer making pictorial, like, basic Spanish food charts for illiterate patients who couldn't read, and I also love art, so that was really fun for me, and I spent a weird amount of that summer on the computer just doing that, because I actually had a really good time. I was able to combine some of my favorite things, Spanish, healthcare, and art, in one project, and so it really was fruitful for me. And so in general, I think that you'll be surprised by if you're able to pick things that you enjoy and activities that fulfill you, then it doesn't seem like a lot of time. The nights that you go to bed a little late, it's not as bad because it's for something that you really enjoyed. So.
Also, and as a current student, like, pick things that you enjoy, but I believe that most of you all are already involved in, like, the community or with the school. So a lot of the activities that you do now will probably continue to be either CAS, with creativity, action, or service. So there's not that much as far as you have to put labor and go out seeking unless you're not that involved anymore right now. But most of the stuff you do right now will continue, and you'll continue your interests.
Also, speaking to the service hours specifically, I had the unique experience of having my service hours fall through and trying to get in touch with an organization that didn't really respond to me. So my whole first semester, almost three quarters of my junior year, I was fighting to get these service hours. And I'm not sure if we still do the service fair.
Yeah.
We do. The service fair is a great opportunity if you don't know like any service organizations out there. That's a great opportunity to find things. Personally, I ended up getting involved with adoption service for cats and dogs. So that's how I ended up doing those service hours. And I believe they have a table at that service fair. But if you're really concerned about it, go to the service fair.
One thing I want to speak on about CAS is that you can also use it as an opportunity to find something that you like that you had no idea, and that's what I experienced. For my like action and service, I did soccer at school here, but then for the majority of the service, I ended up going to an elementary school called H.D. Cook in D.C., and that was something that the first time I went was just, oh, let's just get this over with. I got to get CAS hours so Mr. Mishra gets off my back.
Don't worry.
But, yeah, it's really not that bad. You can avoid that hallway really easily. But once I got there, like, the way that the elementary school kids acted, like, I found out that I love working with kids. Like, it's awesome, and I enjoy that so much. And so I would have never known that or even had, like, that rough idea of, like, something that I enjoy doing for fun. If I hadn't done CAS, and that ended up being what I did last summer for job. I just worked at a church with kids for the entire summer, so I would have never known that. So I think CAS is a unique opportunity to expand your horizons, if I can use that cliche phrase. But yeah.
I'm actually at H.D. Cook right now for CAS.
Yeah.
And I kind of had the same experience where at first, I mean, I don't have any younger siblings, so I didn't have too much experience with younger kids. And it was kind of a thing where I saw at the fair, you know, all my friends are doing this, and I was like, why not? Like, I have nothing else to do, and I should probably get my service hours. But I had pretty much the same experience where after being there for a while, I grew to just love the little kids and have that experience that I've never really had before. And it became a thing, I mean, I'm going today after school. It became a thing where it's like, you know, every Thursday I was thinking, okay, here's another thing. And at first it was a bit of a burden, but you grow to love it. And I think the main thing about CAS is that kind of intrinsic motivation where if you love going, then the extra time that you're putting in doesn't seem like work. It seems like something that you do anyway. So.
Does anyone else have anything to share about their CAS experiences? Go ahead. Eleanor's a junior diploma candidate here at George Mason High School.
Right. Sorry, Ms. Meester didn't introduce me earlier because I arrived late. What you actually asked was about how much time CAS takes, and yes, it is great to hear about how great it is. I can also talk about how I am very much enjoying CAS. But about how much time it takes, from my own experience and for that for homework too, and from that of my friends, I've learned that how much time it takes and how much sleep you get depends on how much into it, again, how much you want to do. To fulfill the actual expectations, to do all your homework, to you know meet all the hours, it may seem like a lot, but it's actually not that much. The thing that keeps me up is that I get really involved in it. So I'm not cautioning against, well, okay, to some extent cautioning against that, I always try to do too much. But just to let you guys know, the reason you stay up, even though you hear all the IB kids complaining, is not gonna be because the workload is too much. It's gonna be because you get very much into it and want to do more work. So if you're the kind of person who does not, like I've been working hard all my life, if you're the kind of person who does not like to do that, then you will be able to work pretty much about the same level that you do at your current year and get by just fine, great A's, if that's what you're getting in your sophomore year. But if you're the kind of person like me who tries to do a lot, who wants to be involved in a lot of things, then that is going to be what keeps you up. So that was just
I think we'll move on to this the next question, if that's okay. You've been waiting very patiently. Thank you so much. You could ask your question.
I was just wondering about your college application essay, like how much the IB diploma like help you like find what you were going to write about or like the, I don't know if they give you prompts, but yeah, how you did that.
My essay actually came from my experience in IB Spanish in sort of how I really didn't want to take that class because I am not the greatest at foreign languages and then ended up taking it. And I didn't do incredibly well in it, but I didn't fail. I got a B, so I'll take it. But my essay was specifically about that IB class and that whole year of how it was just, I don't know, it started from being a chore to being like somewhat enjoyable to the end of it. I actually really enjoyed the class. So that, I mean, my essay was exactly, came from the IB diploma.
Yeah, my college essay I wrote actually in my junior year of IBHL English, and then took that and fixed it up a little and sent it into colleges, and I got into college, so.
Yeah, I was gonna say that too. Miss Tews in her class, she had us write them, but then also, I know Miss Tews and Miss Rader for me were willing to read tons of drafts. Writing lab is open, so I would say like the resources I had through the school because of the IB program helped me write it in that way.
I'm glad you mentioned the writing lab and the other resources you have.
Some classes in IB give you the opportunity to be concise when you write essays. Some applications require you to write essays with only 250 words, which is a pretty short essay. So you have the chance to express what you want in that small amount of space that you were given.
And actually, Allie and I just finished College Apps. So to kind of go with the question of Cass, it's actually very inspirational if you're writing an essay. Colleges ask you kind of what's your main accomplishments, when did you take a risk, when did you fail and then kept on moving. So when you have this Cass, where it's an opportunity to keep on moving forward or take on going something that's been your dream, or such as like making something that has nobody's ever done, such as a Hope Project, or which I'm doing, those are really inspirational, really kind of motivate you. And right now you might not be thinking necessarily what prompts you're gonna do, but later on, when you want to show somebody like who you are, what makes you important, what values, these are things that you can build upon and tell like, this is who I am, this is why I do it. So this is very inspirational and helps you in college essays.
For one of my college essays, I actually wrote about a concept that we discussed in anthropology as well as theory of knowledge, and that was localization versus globalization. And the essay had asked about just to write about kind of like the common good and what that means to you. And so I wrote about, I used to live in a small town in northern Michigan, and it was very localized, like lots of like, you know, small town stores and things like that. And then coming here to DC, everything's very globalized. And so I used those concepts that we talked about in class, and I got into college. Like, I guess what I'm trying to get at is you're gonna hear about so many new things that you'd never been able to. It's gonna like give you a vocabulary to put words to, you know, to put more definitive words to thoughts that you may have had, and that I thought was really helpful because I could explain myself in a more academic way.
Another question from a great risk taker.
If I may return to Cass for just a moment, I know some people have been kind of afraid of the logging for Cass, so if someone could talk about that.
So juniors and seniors sometimes are frustrated by the reflection requirement, and I think that's what Evelyn is speaking about.
So the journals, right?
Correct.
So I'll try that one first. This is sort of connected to the college essays. I wrote my main Common App essay about my experience at the clinic the summer before my senior year. And I don't think I would have necessarily chosen to write that essay if I hadn't reflected on that process a couple of times throughout the summer. So on a practical level, it helped me with my college applications. But I think also, at least in that case, it helps inform a little more what I am interested in right now and I really want to explore in college, because I came across a lot of really interesting social, cultural, economic like issues at that clinic, because it's sort of this cross-section of a lot of different people from interesting walks of life and different stories and problems. And so it helped me realize that that was a area of our society that I wanted to be more involved in. And while I like to think I could have come to that on my own, really having to think about why it interested me helped too.
So before we move on, I realize I should have explained. If you choose as a diploma candidate or a courses student, and you both have that option, to do the IB Creativity Action and Service extracurricular program, you're required to reflect once a quarter in almost like a diary journal entry on the struggles and successes and goals that you have for yourself in each activity that you're participating in. So that, and Evelyn's correct, that current students sometimes find that experience frustrating.
Didn't it used to be once a month? Yeah.
Yes, the IB it Student Advisory Board. Your representatives on the IB Student Advisory Board advocated on your behalf in a very formal written request, and we responded to the request by making the journal requirement once a quarter.
It did used to be once a month, and I actually found that helped me in college because my second semester I had to take a freshman seminar, as most colleges require, and one of the big requirements for that class was writing a daily journal, which was a reflection journal on what we had learned in class that day. And because I'd written these journals every month, and you don't always have something new to write about every month, it allowed me to look at what I'd done that month and go beyond what I had done and reflect on the implications of it then, on the way that I was thinking or on aspects of our society. And I took that and was able to apply that to my freshman seminar and go beyond, like, this is what we learned in class today, and talk about what the implications of that were on a global world.
So I guess I kind of broke the rules and did what you're doing now. I didn't really reflect once a month. I mostly did like once a quarter, and I would write a longer summary, or not a summary, a longer reflection of what I had done. And I thought it was easier for me to look back on what I'd done and understand it rather than trying to, like, you know, midway through a project or an activity, like understanding what I'd done. It just didn't work for me. And so I think that the reflections became a lot easier when I did that, and it's really just not a big deal, like, because it's so easy to just look back on an activity or a season in a sport or something and say, oh, okay, you know, these were my goals at the beginning of the season, and this is what I accomplished, and this is what I could have done differently, rather than trying to, like, write about something that you haven't completed.
So I don't think when I was an IB student we had any of that. We never had to reflect on the CAS hours, but hearing what everyone is saying about it and the process that you guys have to go through, I think it would be just a really beneficial tool, just because, and second of all, like someone else was saying, if you're doing something that you already enjoy, writing about it, especially when you're already writing in all your classes about things you maybe don't enjoy, this is not gonna be a chore. It's gonna be something that's just gonna help you, and it might even be enjoyable.
I wanna shift gears a little bit, because in the last few questions, we've been talking a lot about the IB diploma. And if you guys follow, I expect you to follow and probably improve a little bit the current numbers in the junior class. But right now in the junior class, one in every three students, as we discussed, is pursuing the full IB diploma, but then the other 55% are pursuing IB courses that fulfill the challenges they want to take on. So, Leah, if you wouldn't mind speaking about why you chose, because you, knowing you now, I know you were in a position in 10th grade to do either one and be a successful student. So why did you choose IB certificates, and how have those courses helped you in your current college experience?
Okay, so my senior year, I took 6 IB classes. And then I had French, which wasn't IB, obviously. I think one of the major reasons I decided not to do the IB diploma was because of I knew I was going to be participating in 2 or 3 sports. I had sports outside of school, like club soccer and stuff. And also just because I'm not really strong in languages, and you had to do IB for languages. I think that for those of you who do want to play sports these next few years, even like 3 sports, that's going to be all year round. I think that doing IB courses, even up to like 6 or even like 7, and not doing the full IB diploma is not going to hurt you in any way. I got into most of the colleges I wanted to get into, and I didn't do the IB diploma. So, and I still participated in all the sports, so.
And Leah is very ill this morning, and she still showed up, so thank you so much. Merrick, do you want to say anything on your experiences?
I guess the reason I didn't do the diploma was also language. I took Arabic for most of the beginning of high school, which is not in the IB language or just wasn't offered here. And then as I went forward, a lot of my friends did do the diploma, and I would talk with them about it, and they seemed like they always had a little bit more things to do. I know when the extended essay was due, no one was hanging out that weekend. I was sitting alone in my house thinking of what I could do. But I found that when it came down to it, we'd have conversations about what we were learning in classes, and I didn't take TOK, but I would talk with my friends about what they were learning in TOK and kind of discuss that with what I've been learning in my other classes. So I think it's very helpful to, even if you don't do the diploma, talk with people about what they're learning and try to take in some of that knowledge and still get a positive experience from the classes.
So if you're in the audience for this event or watching it on the television, the IB diploma was a 100% wonderful, glorious, joyous experience for all of you. I worked with 10 out of 11 of you, and I know there were times in the school year you were frustrated, stressed, sometimes at points which we wouldn't have wanted occasionally in the school year. So my next question is, you know, what challenges and obstacles did you face? How did you overcome them? And what would you have done differently now in retrospect in relation to those challenges and obstacles?
Well, a challenge for me was that I'm doing engineering in college, and I always liked math and science over history or languages. And I came to George Mason kind of late, so I wasn't able to take the regular honors classes that would put me in HL science classes or math classes. So I kind of dreaded history and English a little bit, but they gave me tools that I needed in college anyway, so I was grateful I took those classes. But I think that you don't have to be discouraged because you're going to take a certain class you want. Even though I took SL physics and SL math, I was able to get into engineering, and I did just fine my freshman year, and then classes get a lot harder, so be ready for that, and I think IB will get you on track for that.
I really wanted Christian to share that experience. He did SL math and science, and he's an engineering student in one of the best engineering colleges in the United States. And he's a very successful engineering student. So, you know, he really talked to me about how being prepared intellectually for college is what was important for him. And I think sometimes students overthink this idea that you need to study in high school exactly what you're going to study in college. And I think Christian's experience really emphasizes that point, that as long as you are learning to read, think, and write effectively, that prepares you for college. You can be successful.
Yes, what you're doing in high school doesn't dictate what you'll do for your life. Excuse me. Even what you do in college doesn't really dictate how your life will go. You realize you take classes here and there, but in the end, you're getting ready for something greater than just memorizing stuff, taking a test, acing it. You're trying to be a learner for life, and I think that IB was really giving me that through different classes, different homeworks, and stuff like that.
Just to echo that sentiment, so in college, I did an engineering degree, but in high school, I had virtually no background in any of the subjects that I was gonna later take in college. The only physics class that I took was, so when I was in high school, the CP physics class was like your standard, like it didn't lead to anything else. So it was your very basic physics class to take an SOL afterward. So that was the only physics class I had taken in the 10th grade. So by all standards, I guess you could say, I wasn't prepared for college because I hadn't taken any of those things. I had only taken biology, chemistry, history, English, yet I feel like I was really successful in college because of the IB, because again, it teaches you how to learn, not just the facts you're going to be learning in college. So even though, you know, I didn't have the benefit of an AP physics class, and I sat in my 101 class not knowing what a motor was, I ended up doing really well in my classes and really excelling. And even to that point, you know, what you do in college isn't going to dictate what you end up doing after college. I was an engineering major in college, but I'm not doing engineering as my career. So you have a lot of opportunities to learn more things, and I think just as a student, you know, myself, like I like to do things that are going to prepare me down the road for the real world. And knowing a lot about different things and seeing how to interact in different environments is going to help you to do that, because I find myself now being very unique in that, you know, yes, I'm going to be going to med school, and yes, I, you know, had this engineering background, but I also know how to write, and I also know how to express myself, you know, effectively with my peers.
Remember, the question was about struggles, so.
Oh, and then also, I don't think that I would have done anything differently in high school. A lot of people would ask me, you know, why didn't you take a higher level physics class in high school? And yeah, it's a valid point, but I don't think I would have done anything differently. Yeah, I had struggles, and yeah, I was stressed out in, you know, my junior and senior years, but I was also stressed out in college, and that's never gonna go away, sorry to tell you. But you know, this stuff is just gonna help you down the road. So all those struggles and all those hard times are gonna just help you exponentially in the future.
I think the most stressful thing for me that I can remember happening a couple of times throughout those 2 years was that every once in a while, for whatever reason, there would be a bunch of IB sort of assessments all in the course, like a couple of days. And they were some of the most terrifyingly hard, frustrating days. And what I didn't necessarily know at that time and found out my senior year for whatever reason is that you can go to Mr. Misha if you have, say, like 3 tests or 2 tests or an IA, if you know what that is yet, due in classes all in that really short period of time. And he helps you talk to the teachers about maybe rearranging dates. And you'll find that some of your teachers, not that I want them to have to live up with this, but they're understanding. Have an open conversation with your teacher about your schedule, and they want to help you with it. It's not always going to work out, but I always had this impression that for some reason, everything that I was told that I had to do at a certain time was 100% set in stone, and there was nothing I could do about it, and it became this overarching worry in my life at that time, which I spent a lot much more time just being frustrated about than was probably useful.
So for me, I found myself really struggling to figure out what I wanted to do as far as my IB courses, choosing my IB courses, and then what I was going to do in college. So I actually applied to like big state engineering schools and then completely different like small liberal arts colleges. And I found myself kind of realizing that I didn't know what I didn't know. That is to say, there were so many, by taking the IB classes, I found that there were so many like new subjects that I had never, you know, even thought of, like taking my the IB anthropology course, that it kind of just stressed me out, because I thought I had to have it all figured out and, you know that, oh, I'm gonna be an engineer or I'm gonna be a doctor or something, but I came to realize that you don't have to do that. Like I haven't declared a major yet. I don't have to do that until my sophomore year. And so I thought that, I guess I just struggled with trying to find what I am interested in, but I guess I actually came to realize that IB helped me to realize that I can have a bunch of different interests and still be successful.
My biggest challenge in high school came indirectly from the IB diploma. I was unable to take IB HL bio as a certificate student, so I went and said, okay, I'll try to take some classes online. And I ended up trying to take 2 AP classes online during my 2 study halls. And I ended up just not working out, because I just could not handle having that much free time and being able to sit down. So I think doing the intellectual risk taker of, oh, I can take these 2 classes, kind of backfired in my case, because I just was unable to do online courses. And I found that a lot of students had trouble with online courses.
Michelle DeMars and I took AP online calculus our senior year and felt that that was a big mistake too. If you're at all considering an online class, have a teacher to check in with regularly, to ask questions, and to go through material that's unclear for you, because we did not have that set up during our online class, and it was ultimately really challenging for us.
I ended up teaching myself a lot of material, but still do well on the exams.
Yeah, all three of you did well on the exams, so. Which is interesting based on your experience. Okay, we have time for just one or two last questions. So if you have a question, please come on down. Sir, thank you.
So how do I know like what science to take? Because I know a lot of them are 2 years, and is it possible to take like two of them?
I can speak to this. I actually took IB SL chemistry and IB HL biology. I don't know how it's structured now, but my biology class was the 2 years, and then I took chemistry and biology at the same time my junior year. And I'm pretty sure I had to do that because of like graduation requirements. You have to take like three different sciences.
That's true in Virginia. You have to take three different sciences over 4 years for the Virginia Advanced Diploma unless you're an IB Diploma candidate. Okay. If you're an IB Diploma candidate, you can study two sciences if one of them's a two-year IB course over 4 years.
So for me, like, it was just, I actually, for your question, like, I had to do a lot of figuring out, like, my freshman year, you know, what I was going to take when, and I kind of had it all planned out my freshman year before I took any class. So nothing really changed from my freshman year to when I graduated, but that was just me. I had to do that, otherwise I wasn't going to get my graduation requirements.
And if you want to talk specifically, just you don't know which science class you want to take, if you're not a science person, definitely take an SL science class. Maybe choose Enviro Systems and Societies, because from what I know, it was not offered to my year, but is somewhat more geared to non-science people, opposed to physics, or which is very math intensive, if you already know you're a math person. Which, you know, I was not at all. Or bio or chem, which is more applied, but will have more memorization. What do you already know about yourself as a student? What are your strong study skills and what interests you? Other than that, don't make it too complicated on yourself.
Allison, do you want to say something about environmental systems and societies since you are a two-year environmental systems and societies SL student?
Yeah, so at first, my original plan was to take something like SL biology or something like that. But then we had the course IB Environmental Systems and Societies added into Mason, which is a 2-year course, but it's still SL. And I know personally I've never been good at math or science. And so that was one of the main contributing factors that I thought, oh, I can't do the IB diploma because I'm really horrible at those courses. But then with that added in, I was able to take that class, which I'm still in, and I absolutely love it. I know some of my friends would say, oh, it's just an easy class, I'll just take it, but personally, I go hiking all the time, so I'm interested in the class, and it's really an interesting thing to learn about a different type of science that I hadn't really thought about taking before, and because of that course, I'm now able to do the full diploma, which I'm really happy that I ended up doing, so. So it's just an option.
To add to that, I took environmental my senior year, just SL, so it was just 1 year I took it. But now I'm majoring in bio at Mary Washington, and I found that, like, even though you might think it's an easy class, I still apply what I learned in that class to my bio classes, and I mean, I got an A in bio my first semester in college, so you might think that it's just an easy class, but I actually learned stuff that I learned in bio. This year.
We need to conclude. I'm going to ask each of you, you have 15 seconds, every single one of you are going to go down the aisle. Some of you have a longer time to think about it than others. 15 seconds to give 10th graders one bit of advice as they're thinking about choosing their classes. We'll start with whoever's ready.
Everybody's looking at me. Does that mean I have to go?
Because you're at the start of the lane. Yeah, go for it, Eric. We'll just go down the lane. That's the easy way.
I would say challenge yourself immediately, because you can always take stuff off, but it's harder to add stuff on just as it goes on. And then one thing I want to say is that this school is incredible from the standpoint of the resources that are at your disposal. Like, I didn't appreciate it until after I went to college, like what this school does to prepare you not only for college and education past that, but life in general. So I would say just utilize everything that they have here as much as you possibly can, just because it you can't even measure how much it'll help.
We did not ask or pay Eric to say that.
They did.
just be conscious of your choices, and that, I mean, to do the full diploma, there are certain things that you have to do and you're required to do, but as I've already said before today, make them things you like and things that you're going to be happy to be doing.
I would say don't be afraid of things that you think you're bad at, because a lot of times you think you're bad at something until you practice it, and then all of a sudden you realize you might be good at it. And also give yourself balance in the sense of challenge yourself on a few courses, but then pick things that you like or you think you're going to excel at, because it is difficult if you have 7 classes that are challenging you all at one time.
I'd just say be passionate, kind of build off Michelle. If you take classes you're interested in, you'll find it easy to study that stuff and do well. And then if you do well enough, you might even get college credit, which always pays off.
As far as the difficulty of the IB diploma program, there are so many different courses that you can take that you can really tailor the program to your strengths. Like, I focused on English and psychology and theater, and my older brother focused on science, and he's getting his chemistry PhD right now. So it's, you can really tailor it to what you want to take and what you're good at, and then the results will show.
I was going to say, don't feel forced to do the IB diploma. Take the courses that you want to take if you do want to do IB, and they'll still be beneficial to you.
Like everyone else, take classes that interest you. You know what you like, so take those classes. This is the time for you guys to not be scared of taking classes, of trying new stuff, because later on it becomes a little more complicated to find that time to try new things. So try it now.
I would definitely say challenge yourself as much as possible, because taking these classes is going to prepare you well for college, and it's going to make the jump from high school to college that much easier, because you're used to the workload and you're used to, you know, writing long papers and having, you know, it's not a big deal. So just kind of do as much as you can and it'll pay off later.
George Mason and the IB diploma, at least in my experience, was going to prepare me anyway for college. So it really didn't matter what I took. As, you know, a junior and senior, I was going to be able to do well in college anyway. So I guess my one piece of advice is don't be overly concerned about how this is going to affect you 10 years down the road, because all of this stuff is a learning experience. So, you know, take something, again, that you're interested in, and it will pay off.
Just agreeing with pretty much everyone, I'd say don't do a diploma just because it'll look good on a piece of paper down the road. I'd say do it because you're actually interested in the classes that you're taking. Inspiration doesn't have a timeline, so take what you learn now and put that forth into the rest of your life.
Just like everybody else said, this is a wonderful opportunity to kind of challenge yourself and learn more, to take an opportunity to really go out in an area that you want to explore, but you do have to do it for yourself. You do have to have that motivation within yourself to actually push each night, to push to do the work, to meet the deadline, to talk and go out and use those resources. So whatever you choose, make sure it's for you.
My piece of advice would be think about and focus on what you want to do, not what the requirements are, because my personal experience with pretty much all the aspects of IB that I've encountered so far is that the requirements are a lot more flexible than they look at first.
Thank you so much. There's one major important part of the questions I had forgotten to ask that I know parents in the community are particularly concerned about, so I just want maybe you guys to raise your hands and answer this question. And then if Claire can speak on it, because she had focused some time and effort on this issue this year. How many of you got less college credit than your AP roommates or friends may have? Just 3 of you, good. So what I always contend to the parents in the community is that, yes, some colleges might not give as much credit for standard level IB courses. However, these students prove the point that is proven by research over and over again. That has nothing to do with admissions to university. And part two, I contend, the students come back and share with us that they wouldn't change anything regardless of that because of the benefits they see. To what extent is that, for how many of you is that statement true? Raise your hands if yeah. I did not pay or ask them to say that. And I spoke to each of them individually about that question because I want to be challenged if it's not true. For students, so we're really thankful that. If Claire and Surya want to say one last thing about that issue.
Go ahead
first. I know VCU actually has a great credit policy.
Yeah, I mean, and I won't dispute you. I did get a lot of credit. I think 36 credits out of high school. So I graduated with a lot of credits. I was a senior standing when I was a junior. But at the same time, not a lot of those credits went to my major. So, I mean, just because you're getting credits doesn't mean like it's gonna lessen your course load in college. And I don't think I could have done anything differently to get more credits. Just because a lot of times your major and your school, like you're gonna have to take classes that are specific to that school. So there's not a lot you can do about that.
I'm so glad you mentioned that. It's something a lot of parents in the community don't realize is most colleges only give elective credits, and so those credits aren't gonna count. And so students, there was actually a study in Texas that analyzed this question. Students don't graduate early because of credits, whether they're AP or IB students. There might be an exception to that here or there, but generally that's the case. Claire, and then Ben, and then we'll be done.
So because of the program that I'm in at UVA, I don't actually have general education requirements, which on some level was really exciting because I could take some really interesting classes, but then also felt at times like pressure because I don't know what I want to do for certain with my life, and so I didn't have a foolproof plan of how I was going to tackle my future career first semester of freshman year. But I did know that I wanted to keep exploring, and so I'd taken IB higher level art and gotten a 6 on that exam out of 7 and was happy with that. And
it's an outstanding score for reference.
But was looking at the IB credit policy at UVA. And at UVA, you can get credit for a 4 or a 5. You get out of intro to drawing 1, which is the prerequisite course for all of our other
art
classes.
On the AP test.
On the AP test, correct. A 4 or 5 on the AP test. But you needed a 7 on the IB higher level exam to get out of that same class and get credit for it, which is disproportionately harder and happens much less frequently. And while there's a wide range of people who get 6s, and a very small percent of people that get 7s, it still did not add up just on a mathematical level. So I decided, with the help of Mr. Mishra, to send a letter to the IB to the art department at UVA with these statistics, also a online copy of my art portfolio from the past 2 years, because I was worried that if numbers didn't sway them, maybe my art would. And unfortunately, I got a very curt and helpful response that a credit to do any art at UVA, I need to take that intro class unless I have gotten those scores. And their reasoning was that they feel that it's still really important, and they feel if I want to study art in any way, then I need to continue to study with them from the most basic levels, but I don't think I'm going to be studying art at UVA. I was just interested in taking maybe a painting class or a sculpting class, and so maybe this seems like a superficial way in that IB did not help me out, but I had really looked at this program as a way to study things that would be exciting and interesting to me, not to get that college credit because I'm getting little to none currently. But it didn't even help me in this case to take that extra class that I wanted to. So that was frustrating, but at the same time, I'm really glad that I took IB Art because it was the most, possibly one of the most rewarding classes that I took at Mason in general.
Any last comments? Very quickly, please, Ben.
So at Grinnell, they don't have any general education requirements, nor are there course distribution requirements beyond like what will fulfill your major. So even if I had gotten a lot of IB credit, which I didn't, I got placement, which is still really helpful because I was able to take the classes that were at my level, so I got into the Spanish class that would, you know, logically follow taking IB Spanish 4, and I got into, you know, an English class that followed taking HL English. So even if I didn't get credit, I got to take the classes that I wanted to take. And no one graduates in less than 4 years, really, at Grinnell. It's not encouraged, so the credit for me wasn't a big deal at all.
Well, I hope this time was valuable for you in you choosing your classes in the future. The start of second semester, the counselors will meet with you to give you a program of studies. Your teachers will begin discussing your course options. And if you signed up to be interested in the IB diploma, I'll meet with you two more times. We're headed to third period. Let's give these students a loud round of applause for their time with you today. A standing ovation would be nice too. Thank you guys so much for your time. And please continue to visit us at George Mason High School.